it stops. We break that cycle of harm. That harm that causes damage and disruption, which causes, amongst other things, resource depletion, which causes conflict and can lead to war. It's a never-ending cycle that spirals onwards and upwards and upwards and upwards. But it's actually about saying, okay, now we stop it, now we say no more. Now we put in place a law. And a law is just a physical manifestation of a moral imperative. What we decide in criminal law, we say, okay, morally that's wrong, so we make it legally wrong. Theft is a very good example. Can you imagine if you were to walk down the road, someone grabs your bag, and there's a police officer there, you say, officer, stop that person, they've taken my bag. And the officer says, why should I do that? It's not a law, it's not illegal, there is no law against this. You'd think the world had gone mad. Well, at the moment, if I'm to stand up and say, stop that company from causing mass damage and destruction, I have a police officer saying to me, why should I do that? It's not a crime. Somehow, we've managed to absent those who are causing the most damage and destruction of all. We managed to determine what we want to stop at a very lower level, but when it comes to the worst crimes of all, we seem to shy away from this. And sometimes this is also because actually, the hardest thing it is to do is to face the shadow self. And in a way, this is what a law of ecocide is about. It's facing the shadow self. It's about saying our systems do not work, and this must stop. And that we come together on this. And we give a choice. It is your choice. If you want to continue that cycle of harm, then you become accountable in a criminal court of law. But if you choose to go in a different direction, then we do genuinely begin to create a better world. So this is really powerful legislation. But what I didn't realize, when I proposed this into the United Nations 3 years ago, I submitted it into the UN Law Commission, I fully worked out a proposal on it. What I didn't know was that this was a law that had already been on the table in the United Nations from the mid-80s to the mid-90s. At that time, there was a decision to codify the existing international crimes against peace. So we have genocide, we have war crimes, we have crimes against humanity, and the most recent one is called crimes of aggression, the run-up to war. And there was a fifth one there, and that was ecocide. So we had special rapporteurs in the UN drafting on that. We had lawyers, we had member state representatives, we had related UN organizations all involved in this. From 1985 to 1996. And in 1996, at a closed-door meeting of the Working Group on Crimes Against the Environment, it was announced, despite the fact that many countries had gone public in supporting it, that it was just going to be completely removed from the text, both as a war crime and a peace crime. No reason was given. Many countries objected, but amazingly, we now have two lever-arch files of documentation to show the history of this law. What we do know is that four countries had objected to it at that time, and they were...
USA,
yes. UK, yes. No, not Russia, no. Not China, no. France and the Netherlands. But the beauty is that something happens when an idea is of its time. Try to push it down over here, and it pops up over here. And that's precisely what had happened. So something's at play here. This is a law that's really of its time. And now the support for this is growing enormously. There's a momentum behind it. Last year, I was invited by a group of governments to put together a timeline to put in place this as an international law to get an amendment on the table at the review conference of the Rome Statute, which is June 2015, and for it to be fully implemented by 2020. How fast can we turn this around? How fast can we really do this? Give a 5-year transitional period for it. There's no reason for this to be decades and decades. It's already had decades in in the milling of working it out and talking it through anyway. Because just imagine this, had it been put in place as it was originally intended in 1996, in fact it would have been tabled in 1998, we would have had 15 years of something very, very different instead. We would have a world where the innovation in the other direction was the norm. We would have a world where renewables were the norm. We would have a world where we were no longer running on fossil fuel. That would have been our past already. We would be in a very different place here. So 54 countries last year asked me to legally advise on this as a proposal. And it's gaining momentum all the time. Here's the thing, putting in place a law of ecocide only needs 81 people in the world to agree it. This is a law that can be passed very, very easily. Now, it just so happens those 81 people are heads of state. But...
or they're ambassadors.
Yes, or their ambassadors can speak on their behalf. But here's the interesting thing. It needs an amendment to possibly the most important document in the world, called the Rome Statute. And it sets out the existing international crimes. It put in place the International Criminal Court. It just needs one head of state to stand up and call for that amendment, and it has to be tabled. And then all the signatories to that document, that Rome Statute, all those member states that are signatories, there are 121 countries that are signatories, of all of them, only 2/3 need to come on board. And it doesn't matter if America doesn't come on board, because they're not a signatory. So their vote doesn't count. So here's what's so very interesting thing about it, is that it can be small island states. 54 small island states are signatories to the Rome Statute. This isn't just about corporate ecocide, this is about naturally occurring ecocide. At the moment, there is no legal duty of care to give assistance to those small island states that are about to go underwater. This would create a legal duty of care for all nations to come together and start planning what to do now, because we have environmental refugee issues that are looming over the horizon very, very fast. So this has huge implications, not just for human-caused ecocide, but also how we take responsibility for those that are adversely impacted by naturally occurring ecocide. This is ultimately, it's a law that is a crime against nature, but it's also a crime against humanity. Destroy the very land that we walk on, and we destroy our ability to live in peaceful enjoyment. It's also a crime against future generations. The decisions we make here and now in our life will have huge implications for not just our children, but our children's children, and those that aren't even thought of yet. And this is the thing. You know, when we're in time of crisis, it is a calling to arms. It's a calling upon each and every single one of us to stand up and give voice. It's about daring to be great, to be in service to something greater than the self. It's not about the small steps here, it's about the quantum leap. It's about drawing the line in the sand and saying, enough, no more. I break that cycle of harm that's at play to the whole of humanity, to the whole of our earth. And I stand up and I support this law of ecocide. This is hugely empowering. Because when we do stand up and we say, enough, no more, we're setting boundaries of what we see as being acceptable in our lives. And that's very, very powerful. Because actually what's playing out in the wider world, in the macro, is just a mirror of what's playing out in the micro. What cycle of harm do we have? What are our inner ecocides that we need to say, enough, no more, this must stop? So this is the thing. I'm calling upon you to dare to be great. This is about leadership. This is about leaving a legacy. This is about bold, moral, and courageous leadership in each and every single one of us. And saying, enough, this must stop now. Because this is the thing. When we step outside of our comfort zone, and sometimes just stepping forward and saying, no more, I don't want this. I want my country, my head of state, to support this law. Sometimes we're stepping out of our comfort zone. But when we step out of our comfort zone, that's where the magic happens. So I'm daring you, each and every single one of you, to be great here. Stand up, speak out. Last time, when a law of ecocide was removed literally off the table from that draft, nobody knew what had happened in the greater public scheme of things. This time round, we can't let that happen. Everything I have done is open source. It's online. You can find it at Eradicating Ecocide. And there's so much more out there now about it as well. It needs so much more than just one lawyer standing up and speaking out. It's actually about each and every single one of us standing up and speaking out. And that can be through film, that can be through written word, that can be through spoken word. There's so much we can do. This is really about being a sacred activist and coming from a place of peace, not conflict. This is about recognizing that this ultimately is a crime that can and will help take us to a greater world, a world of peace, not damage and destruction. So that's my call upon each and every single one of you. I'm daring myself to be great in all of this. And if each and every single one of us takes up that challenge and does our part in the greater scheme of things, and hears that calling to be greater in service of something greater than self, and stand up and speak your truth about what you believe to be true and right in this world, then something really magical does happen. Because what we do is we begin to sing a new song. And we begin to sing that song so beautifully that others will want to join as well. So I ask you to join me and sing this new song for a beautiful new world. Thank you.
Earth we call our home. This earth we call our home.